servers, multiple websites, and almost 500 telephone poles, including a live feed tonight on Facebook for those unable to attend in person. And I believe we have some media also present. We always want to improve this format, so before you leave, please gather a survey and fill it out and hand it in. The debate will adjourn at 9 p.m., and the candidates are all encouraged to meet with the attendees in front of the school afterwards for some one-on-one time. I appreciate everyone's time and for attending tonight, and I'd like to introduce our moderator for the debate, retired teacher and former vice principal and the VP of the Mount Dennis Community Association, Judith Hayes.
So this is going to be how the evening will go. First of all, each of the candidates will give a speech of 2 minutes, and no more than 2 minutes. And our timekeeper, Cherry is the most important person in this room. She's the timekeeper, and she will show them an orange card when you're at your 90-second point, and a red card. And you'll be put off 30 seconds later, okay? If you go on, I might have to intercede, that would be trouble. When you ask your question, you'll see on your question sheet whether it should be asked to all candidates or one candidate. If it's asked to all candidates, each one will be given a minute to respond, and they will answer in rotation, so it's not the same person starting first every time. If it's addressed to one candidate, that candidate will have a minute to respond, and all the other candidates, if they want to, they're not obliged to, can have 30 seconds to respond. And for further initial responses and further comments, each candidate will see an orange card 15 seconds before their time elapses, and then a red card, which means you can stop. We would ask that candidates making comments, address the issue by making new and perhaps different points, so that we have a breadth of opinions. And as I said, the maximum time limit will be 30 seconds. At the end of the evening, round about 10 to 9, unless we run out of questions earlier, which I'm sure we won't, each candidate will be given 30 seconds to tell you why you should vote for them. And the candidate who started in their opening speeches first, that person will go last, so we'll go in reverse. And after that, there'll be brief closing remarks by Simon Chamberlain from Mount Dennis Community Associations. And so let's start off from here. We'll go in this order with your 2 minute speeches. Ahmed.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I want to begin really by thanking the organizers of this debate. It's an opportunity for us to have a really important conversation. And all of us here have different political affiliations and different visions of how we would like to see our country move forward. But we're all motivated by the same thing, which is to make sure that we contribute whatever we can to make a better Canada. And I want to thank not just the organizers, but also all of you for coming, for attending, and for having this conversation about the future of our country. And I can tell you that is quite a privilege, because in many parts of the world, this kind of format and this kind of event would simply not be possible. I got involved in politics in 2015 to run for office, simply because I was tired of witnessing the cuts and the attacks on community services that we all benefited from. And I was motivated to defend those services, but also to expand them for the future generation. And a community like York Southwestern, a community that I was intimately involved in and have remained involved in for the last 20 years, whether it is tutoring at-risk kids in their homes, in a number of parts of this riding, as well as choosing this neighborhood to open my small business when I graduated from law school. Or whether it is to run for office to defend, again, the community services that that we all rely on. This is the community that, for me, inspires me to do better every day, to fight hard, and to create the kind of community voice in Ottawa that will reflect your hopes and aspirations. And the job of government really is to make sure that we create more opportunities for our young people, but to also remove obstacles and barriers for people to fulfill their full potential. And if you look at what we've been able to achieve together over the last 4 years, we have a lot to be proud of, but moving forward, we know the job is not done, and I'm excited about the opportunity to continue with our work. Thank you very much.
South-Weston. And I'm really excited to be here. Actually, this is my first debate being here. In fact, I understand it's our Liberal candidate's first debate as well, too, so we're sharing that same honor. So I'm really excited to be here. I am your local candidate. When York South-Weston is the first neighborhood I grew up in, actually, right at Jane and Warner, my family first came to this country. I live in York South-Weston right now on Chithui, on Chichewa, for those of you who know. And York South-Weston is where I've worked for several years, helping young people and their families get the services that they desperately needed. York South-Weston is where I raised my daughter. It's where I go grocery shopping. I shop right at the No Frills, right at Black Creek and Eglinton. And it's where I get my hair cut on any numerous Saturdays. Those of you who know, Saturdays are very busy on Jane or on Weston or on Eglinton. And this is my home. York South-Weston is in my veins. And it would be an honor to represent you on October 21st. We know there are challenges. York South-Weston is a gem of a community, but we absolutely know that there are challenges. Our seniors continue to struggle to having make tough choices between medication and their rent or their mortgage, choosing between groceries and their medication. Housing costs are at crisis levels. Climate change is sweeping across our community. And we see how many of our communities are flooded from Maple Leaf right down the Rock Cliffs line. Our healthcare system is deteriorating right in front of our eyes. Meanwhile, the gap between the rich and all the rest of us just continues to widen. And we've seen nothing done about it from this past 4 years or previous Liberal governments before that. It's the same old story, and we need someone who's going to stand up for us. So, on October 21st, a vote for me, Yaka Tawalde, Jagmeet Singh, and the NDP is a vote for you. Because we are in it for you. Because we need a government that's on our side. And I would be honored to represent you. Thank you for your time. Look forward to talking to you some more. Thank you very much.
I guess we're standing up. Again, thank you very much for participating in democracy. Chat with a gentleman earlier. It's amazing how few people take the time to suit up and show up and participate in the voting process. My name is Nicky Ward. I am a proud member of the Green Party of Canada. And unlike anybody else on this stage, we have no party whip, which means that the opinions expressed here are mine, and the opinions that I can express on your behalf in Ottawa are yours. That's not true for any other candidate that has to face the party whip. Elizabeth May made a joke, and she's a very funny lady, by the way, as well as being very bright. And she said, we are a one-issue party, and that one issue is Canada. Well, I'm a one-issue candidate, and my one issue is York South-Weston. When I look at the environment, I don't think of a polar bear sitting on an iceberg. I think of Black Creek. I think of the Humber River. I think of the air quality. I think of the water our children have to drink and the air our children have to breathe. The environment is right here, right now, in this room. And the Green Party was the only place I could find where those kind of vital, local discussions could take place. During the last election at the municipal level, we saw a loss of local representation. We have fewer representatives at the municipal level. Now, some would argue that's not made a lot of difference. But at the provincial level, we're also underrepresented. We have so little local representation that we need a federal candidate who will step up and represent your Southwestern, not the cabinet, not the prime minister, but where we are right now. That's an environmental issue that I'm here to talk about, and that's why I hope and pray that you vote for me on October 21st.
As my colleagues here have said, I would like to as well congratulate everyone that's here today. I think it's really important, regardless of age, regardless of socioeconomic status, that you stand up and take what's right as Canadian citizens, and that's your vote. And that's very important. Regardless of party affiliation, no matter what, it's really important to exercise that. My name is Jasmine Rattan. I am the Conservative candidate here for York Southwestern. And it may surprise some of you that I am here, because from my understanding, the last 4 years, the last four times, candidates haven't been here. But this is, I'm here today to reaffirm to York Southwestern that I will be here for you, regardless of whatever is standing in my way. Regardless of all the, you know, well, let me just retract a bit. I actually want to let you know who I am. I am an immigrant. I am a mother. I am an ethnic minority. I am a woman, so I understand what it is like to go through whether it's cultural insensitivities, socioeconomic differences. And one of the things I want to talk to you about here today is that I have a background in community economic development. I have worked all across the world on this topic, and I'm here today running because I feel that in Canada we are doing a disservice to our citizens. I believe that we're not taking enough account of our citizens, whether it's new immigrants, whether it's refugees, whether it's people that have been here for over 40, 50 years. And I believe that this divisive politics that's been caused by previous governments is causing some of the fragmented issues that we have. Not only here in North Southwestern, when you look at the community, I've knocked over 50,000 doors, and telling you, I've seen that you need change, that you want someone who's willing to stand up for your rights, and someone who's willing to give you fiscal responsibility in an age where it seems like we have an open credit card. The government has an open credit card to our pocketbooks. Anyways, on October 21st, I hope you vote for me. I look forward to answering any of the questions that you have here for me today. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for inviting me tonight. As people are aware, in this election, the newest party on the block is the People's Party of Canada. And we're the fastest growing party in Canadian history. Currently we have over 40,000 members in just over a year. One of the things that brought the People's Party together is the foundation of our party and our principle, our party, is four main key principles. And that is personal responsibility, individual freedom, fairness, and respect for all Canadians. So we're a very inclusive party. All our policies deal with the country as a whole, and we will not be catering to any special interest groups in developing our policies. We're going to get into some of those later, I'm sure. So another thing, a little bit about myself. 25 years I spent in the military, 4 years as a soldier, around 21 years as an Air Force specialist. Speaking politically, I guess a relevant thing would be as I traveled with Prime Minister Jean Chrétien on international missions, and I was responsible for scanning for the bombs on the plane, which is probably a good thing to do. Again, I look forward to getting some of our policy details as we discuss things tonight, and thank you very much for inviting us. It's hard for this party to get here, just so you know, if you're aware of what's going on in the media. We're having a little bit of a hard time with our free speech, so thank you very much, and we'll get into it.
Could I just ask that there's a lot of people standing at the back. Can you please take seats? There's a lot of seats over here. We really don't want to block that area for fire safety reasons. There's lots of seats on the right down here. There's quite a lot here on the left. Thank you.
wants to come up?
Just while we're getting sorted, I don't know how many of you saw on the news today and yesterday a story about a young woman who went to the doctor. She had some bruising, which was sort of strange, and the diagnosis was that she had leukemia, and she had weeks or months to live. She was 18 years old, and there's a video that's going viral of her sitting up in a hospital bed, holding cards up, giving her message, and saying that she's 18 years old, and she took the time to vote for the first time, so why can't you? And it's just a very, very moving video, and several of the leaders of the parties sent responses to it. So hopefully lots of people see it who are undecided about whether to bother to go and vote, because it's a really very, very valuable treasure, really, that we have in a democratic society to be able to go and vote. Some of you have come from countries where you weren't able to go and vote. So please encourage everybody to come out on the 21st. Okay, Sarah?
Thank you. If elected, what is your party going to budget for infrastructure projects needed due to climate change? We have had fires in the east, snowstorms in Manitoba, rising water levels, and flooding on Toronto Island. What practical relief will you bring?
Thank you. It's a very important question. It's an issue that is of utmost priority for our government. We voted for a motion to declare climate change a national emergency in Canada. And we have invested significantly in climate change, and we will make sure that we build up on those investments. A third of the overall investments we made in infrastructure are on green infrastructure, and some of that has flowed down to York South-Weston. I was able to fight for 3.5 years for additional funding flood mitigation and to provide flood basements right here in York Southwestern, and I was able to finally get $73.2 million of federal money to go into York Southwestern, and I can absolutely promise to you that I will continue fighting to get some of that climate change money to York Southwestern to make sure that we deal with the real effects of climate change now, because they are occurring now and not in the future.
Flooded just last summer, so I see this myself. And families in Rockcliffe Smythe are tired of consistently having their homes flooded away. We see the same thing happening in Maple Leaf, so climate change impacts us directly. And I appreciate what our Liberal candidate has said, but the reality is that we've seen the day after that a climate crisis emergency was declared by the Liberal Party, the next day they bought a pipeline for $4.5 million. But what we've committed to, I brought Jagmeet Singh right here to walk the streets of Hilldale, Carey Drive, and we've committed to no strings attached funding, additional $2 billion to improve the infrastructure that's long been ignored since 1980s, 300,000 green new jobs to remove subsidies from oil and gas companies, and immediately start investing in clean, alternative energy that's renewable. That is a real strategy around fighting for climate change, investing in infrastructure, investing in your Southwesting, because we're in it for you. Thank you.
Clearly, this is right in our beta with this Green Party in Canada. We have the most fully costed, most comprehensive, and workable plan to actually help get us out of this climate crisis. But I have to take exception to some of the things my colleague has said. Firstly, flood mitigation is a municipal issue, and I'm sure he's promised some of the money, but if you look at the science, it's the city that's doing that, not the federal government. On the same basis, the water that floods through here on a regular basis is not clean, it is not Evian, it is filthy, filled with industrial, commercial, and agricultural waste that flows through our rivers, and in these deposits here. As to the lake itself, the flood control there, the outlet is at Cornwall, and that is a federal responsibility that hasn't changed. So why don't you let the water out of Lake Ontario? Ask my colleague. Sorry.
Thank you.
If we need to the water, there's a tap at Cornwall. Open the bloody tap, let the water out, and stop sandwiching York Southwestern between the two.
Thank you. So, Canadians have trusted over the last. Canadians over the last years, for several years, we've known that climate change is an issue. We've trusted the Liberal government to protect the environment and lower Canada's emissions. Instead, what they got us was a carbon tax. And so, the flooding that's happening here in York Southwestern is something that's quite unfortunate. And as I know many of you know in this room, that I'm not from this community, so let's not hide that. However, to me, I'm extremely shocked that this is happening. And the Conservatives, what we've done is we've launched a 65-page plan, which our plan is to look at the environment overall and invest in infrastructure, not tax the people, because what we've realized is the Canadians are overtaxed, and you need to have more affordable, life isn't affordable. And so what we're gonna do is instead of taxing Canadians, we're gonna tax the biggest polluters, and that money we're gonna use to reinvest into infrastructure. And my goal as your representative of York Southwestern is to ensure that you get that, because I stood in the flooded waters the other day and I'm shocked that this is happening, so.
Well, you're probably not gonna believe this, but People's Party have pretty close policies with the Green Party when it comes to climate change. We're going to talk about them for sure. So one of the things that we disagree on, and I think every other party, is we don't believe there's a climate emergency. And let me explain what that's all about. So we believe it's a joint venture between the federal government and the provincial governments as far as taking care of our rivers, lakes, clean water, and making sure our environment here in Canada is properly taken care of. And the other thing is we also capture more CO2 in Canada than we actually expend into the atmosphere. So maybe the rest of the world should be paying us the money.
Could I have Ed and Michelle come up, please, for their question?
I'm sure you've all done so, but you have all turned your phones off, haven't you? Because you're good people.
Hello, my name is Doug Langley. I've been a resident in York Southwestern for a long time. I've got a question for all the candidates. What is your opinion about having a minimum sentence occurring when a crime is committed using a firearm? For example, a 2-year sentence in addition to any additional sentences imposed.
I'm sorry, could you repeat the question? It's difficult to hear that.
Sure. What is your opinion about having a minimum sentence occurring when a crime is committed using a firearm? For example, a 2-year sentence in addition to any additional sentence imposed.
Thank you for that question. You know, in York Southwestern, it's no secret. We're largely in the news when gun violence occurs. That seems like when we're mostly on CP24. I hear it all the time in this community. I've worked in this area myself, actually, working with young people. We worked with a lot of young people who were in trouble with the law. And I'll simply put, minimum sentences and gun crimes, we're too late when we're starting to address it there. We need to start addressing these issues before someone decides to pick up a gun. That is the way we address it. And what we see and what research shows us and what my experience working on the ground here, the best way to fight gun crime is by making sure people have housing to live in, by making sure we're addressing the dropout rate, by making sure we address the vast amount of poverty we have in this community. We've seen the same old answer from other communities, more investments in prisons and police and courts. And while they may be well-meaning, they are far from hitting the mark, and we need to make sure we're addressing that. And that's what our plan is all about.
Oh, comments on it, please?
Can people not hear me? Or is it too muffled when I talk?
You want to do a mic check? Go ahead. Do a mic check. 1, 2, 3.
Mic check. Vote MVP. Mic check. Vote Yakutovic. Mic check. Vote Jugmans.
Okay. Can you maybe set my timer, please? Thank you very much. I think I still remember the question. Gun controls. But the Green Party is all about good stewardship. And so part of the challenge right now is that people are charged with serious gun crimes and are getting out on bail. It's even before it gets to sentencing. And that's a problem that should be addressed at the federal level. Similarly, the guns are coming from the United States. They are smuggled into this country, and that is an international / RCMP, in other words, federal issue. So we have a lack of enforcement. I'm not going to do it to the gentleman next to you. As to minimum sentencing, I think there's a challenge around that because we need flexibility. But there's no question in me that anybody who takes a handgun to a crime should also be charged to the fullest extent. So with the assumption that they are going to kill someone at that stage. So we need to charge people with more crimes. We need to stop the guns coming into this country, and we need to stop letting people out on bail who have these serious crimes and charges against them. That's one thing.
Sorry, could I ask everyone to speak directly into the mic? Because some people are having difficulty.
How was that last one? Was that okay?
Yeah.
Vote Green, Nikki Ward, October 21st. Yeah. Mic check.
Okay. So the Conservative Party, we believe that we need to crack down on gangs and gun crime. And we believe that the current legislation that's there is not adequate enough. We are not giving enough support to our police forces. We are not actively targeting the causes of gun violence. And let's face it, folks, realistically speaking, Ed Mark Saunders has said this himself, 80% of gun violence that occurs in Toronto is from illegal guns that are being brought over by the border. So this gang violence does not just start and York South-Weston, but it's an issue that is across Canada and something that we really need to make sure that we're keeping our borders safer, that we are cracking down on criminals, that we're actually putting gangs into the criminal code. To be honest, I am not a lawyer, and I was surprised that gangs are not defined in the criminal code, so that creates loopholes for them to escape. That creates loopholes for them to get out of bail. And what we're trying to do is, if you are charged with a gun crime of violence, you will be having heavy penalties, and I believe that that's the way we are.
I think the question is mandatory minimum sentence for crimes using guns. Can you hear me? How's that? Okay, so mandatory sentences for crimes using handguns or any guns would definitely be supported by the party. Again, complex problems have complex solutions, and this is a joint federal and local law enforcement issue. So the People's Party has, of course, the ability to help what local law enforcement has got to do with the guns coming across from the United States, for example. And there's all kinds of ways you can work together to solve that. One other thing, though, is we see that there's a gun crimes then get turned into legally policies that affect law-abiding gun owners. So we don't like the new direction that's going on in Ottawa right now, where if a gun crime occurs, even a very nasty one, they immediately try to put policies in place to take freedoms away from law-abiding gun owners. So we're totally against that type of policy generation because of crime. So thank you.
Thank you. We in the Liberal Party understand that you have to be tough on crime, but you also have to be tough on the causes of crime. And the way to do that is to have a comprehensive approach to all of this. You can't just say that you're going to tackle gun violence by cracking down on the smuggling of guns, for example. And it's very rich that the Conservative candidate talks about the border. They cut $390 million from the CBSA. I mean, they didn't really invest in the border.
office, we are putting $327 million into this, and we're pledging another $250 million in a comprehensive strategy that not only tackles crime, but tackles the causes of crime. Because every young person that we lose to a gang is a loss not only for themselves, but for our community.
Clarify what kind of medical procedures you're talking about?
Medical freedom. Choices for medical interventions, procedures, and treatments. Medical freedom is according to the Canadian Freedom, Charter of Freedom and Rights.
We'll just talk about gun control. Oh my goodness, I could start. All right. Self-determination is a key platform within the Green Party, a key principle that we adhere to. We believe firmly in universal health care, universal child care, the full portability of that health care within Canada as guaranteed under the Canada Health Act. We find that in Canada, there is a paucity, a lack of federal standards of care, and therefore it falls to the lowest common denominator when traveling throughout the provinces as to the kind of care that you receive. And so we feel that that is a federal issue that needs to be addressed. As to the freedom of choice in other countries, we have a limited control over those, but if you're talking about female circumcision, I am firmly against it. If you are talking about a woman's right to choose here and elsewhere, I am firmly in favor of it, as is my party.
As a Canadian citizen, I believe that we all have rights to medical freedom. However, I believe that the choices that we make as individuals affect us all. So, you know, I've seen, and I'm not picking on any specific group, but I've seen cases where, you know, in this day and age where there's so many diseases and there's so many things going on, and I've worked overseas and I've worked in different places, and what I find in Canada is that maybe perhaps because we are not as familiar, I mean, a lot of us are coming from these countries, so I'm not including you in these, but in terms of when we're coming in and we're seeking medical attention, our rights as citizens should take place. And I believe that universal healthcare should be accessible for everyone. I believe that you have a right to decide where you're gonna have your healthcare. However, I know that there's inequalities in the system. So on that note, I will have to end there.
So the People's Party has, again, wants the provinces that is actually directly responsible for delivering health care to take the responsibility of doing such things. So for example, wait times in Ontario, for example, the province and the federal government have given tremendous amounts of money to reduce wait times in Ontario, and they have not gone down and gone up. There is certain procedures and certain areas of healthcare treatment that have gone down, but related to the amount of money that was spent, that was passed on to the province, it's not doing the job.
we are guided by that. And Section 7 of the Charter clearly says that people and individuals have the autonomy over their own bodies. But the second point is to make sure that healthcare in Canada continues to be accessible, continues to be universal. And unfortunately, under 10 years of Stephen Harper and the Conservatives, we saw an erosion of that universality of healthcare. And we have done a lot over the last 4 years to ensure that, once again, that healthcare is free and universal for all Canadians, and you can count on the Liberals to continue to do that.
You know, when we think about what medical freedom means, people are being forced to make a choice about how they get access to medication right now. We have seniors in our communities who have to choose between their medication and their housing, medication and their groceries. That's no choice at all. So when we talk about freedom and, you know, freedom to access what kind of health care you need, then we need to truly implement universal pharmacare. That is long overdue. Our Liberal candidate, my friend here, talk about, you know, the need to defend universal pharmacare when they've been promised, the Liberals have promised since 1993. I mean, the Raptors didn't even exist yet then when they've been promising it. And here they are talking about it right now. So, once again, you know, we can blame the Conservatives all we want, but the Liberals have continued the erosion right before our eyes. That's why we are committed to a universal coverage for pharmacare, universal coverage for dental care, universal coverage for vision and mental health. It is head-to-toe coverage with the NDP, because that is what we believe in. We are the ones under Tommy Douglas to make sure we have health care in this country, and now we want to expand it and bring Tommy Douglas' vision to full fruition. So thank you very much.
I have Vernell up to the deck.
Thank you for that question. Affordability of housing is something that affects all sociocultural backgrounds, affects all ages. I've seen at the doors seniors who are struggling to make ends meet because everything is becoming more expensive. I have my sister who is a millennial, who is a professional, who is still trying to afford to get a home. So one of the biggest things is that what we're trying to do is to reduce the regulatory barriers that the Liberal government had placed in, especially for new home buyers. We're going to reduce the stress tests so that new first-time home buyers can have access. And one of the biggest things is, back to the things that we are campaigning on, is affordability. When you have more money in your pockets, then you will also have more money to pour towards the things that you need versus letting the government decide where your money should be placed. So, and the other thing that we're going to do is we're going to look into the Federal Reserve lands and determine what lands that are available that we can release for creating new housing.
Cost of living in your tribe, especially this neighborhood. So by lowering your taxes and putting more money in your pockets, and it's not the only, there's many policy positions we have to put more money in your pocket. I invite you to look up our party, because it's a new party. You might want to look at all the policies online, and you'll see how they directly translate into you being able to afford more choice in your living conditions. Thank you.
Couple of things. One is the National Housing Strategy. We are in year three of that National Housing Strategy that has already resulted in the delivery into Toronto of 58,000 new housing units. So my opponents at the table can talk about theories. We have a record. We have delivered. In my first year at the Federal Parliament, I worked hard with my fellow council to save all subsidy housing for seniors right here in York Southwestern. We have brought thousands of units in York Southwestern. We've delivered $1.3 billion to renovate and refurbish thousands of units in TCHC funding. That is a record that we've delivered.
Thank you for the question. Housing is a crisis right now. I live in this community. I pay rent in this community myself. My building alone, rent increased from $900 for a one-bedroom to $1,650. The average rent in Toronto right now for a one-bedroom apartment is $2,300. So I don't know what delivery my liberal opponent here is talking about, but that doesn't sound like delivery on affordable housing to me.
Yeah.
In fact, 90% of the National Housing Strategy liberals are talking about right now is not coming until after the election. The improvements to Toronto community housing, the $1.3 billion we saw announced, is not coming until after the election. That is buying votes, folks, and that is not right. That is why we're committed to building 500,000 affordable homes across this country, half of that built in the first 5 years. We are going to be making sure that true affordability means no more than 30% of your income to go to housing. So people are paying more than that right now, which is quite a lot. I mean, maybe my opponents can spend some time in the riding. That we want to provide $5,000 of relief to people right now who are paying above 30% of their income. And we want to make sure homeowners, first-time home buyers, can actually afford to buy homes in their communities by doubling the home buyer's tax credit to $1,500. That is a real plan. That is what we're going to do. Thank you very much.
Once again, my friend in office is a stranger to the truth. The Toronto community housing is a municipal issue. As my other colleague has said, these are promises, and we know how good those little promises are. One of the things we need to do right now is to increase the amount of rental housing available immediately in the city of Toronto, and the federal government has it within its power to do so right now. Number one, by eliminating corrupt speculation in the Toronto real estate marketplace. This is a holiday, this is a vacation town for people trying to launder their money. That's one of the problems. We have Airbnb and similar that are taking rental units out of the population. Again, the federal government could do this. We have ghost houses, 60,000 homes in Toronto that are unoccupied. And so all of those things are well within the federal government's purview to tax and affect immediately, in addition to building the much needed housing stock, which is a longer term cycle. So I don't buy what's been said by the city and the incumbent. Don't buy it at all.
So, could I have the next question asker, Nastasko?
Good evening, everybody. My name is Renelle Donnelly, and I believe one of the demographics that we haven't heard much about is the youth of York Southwestern. So my question to the five of you is, what are three main issues you believe young people face in York Southwestern, and what are you gonna do, not your party, but what are you gonna do to address them? Thank you.
To say that something that would really be great for the youth of York Southwestern would be to maybe learn a little more about Canada and get out of the city, any opportunity you have, to see all of Canada and see the different ways people live across Canada and learn and understand that we have a very large country with different needs in different areas. And this question, yes, is specific to this area, but I think you'll find there's lots of ways to explore and expand your understanding of Canada. You may want to live in a different location. I lived in five or six places across Canada, and every place I loved. So that's what I'd say. Explore Canada.
Thank
One is to make sure that we engage youth to make sure that they are feeding into the policy-making process. One of the proudest things that I've been able to do as a member of parliament, which I'm keen to continue to do, is to actually create a youth council so that we can meet frequently and hear directly from them on what the issues are that they The second thing is youth need opportunities. And in my first year as a member of parliament, even after our Liberal government fulfilled its promise to double the number of youth jobs in York South-Weston, double was not good enough for me. I went back and I said, we need more. York South-Weston is a priority neighborhood, we need more. And guess what? We got more, we tripled the number of jobs in York South-Weston, and every single year after that, I built in that success.
That's a really important question, and it's something that I've been working in. My time here in York South-Weston is also working at a youth charity in this community. And one of the many things that we hear are young people can't afford to live in this community, because guess what? Young people are just like everybody else. We need to start understanding that. They need affordability. They need to be able to find housing. Young people are dropping out of school so that they can find jobs, so they can help pay rent. Help contribute to their communities. It is a crisis that we have around affordability that young people are facing. So we need to make sure that that's what we're investing in. And I encourage our Liberal incumbent to spend some time in the writing, because guess what? Young people are not finding jobs. Once again, 500,000 affordable homes across this community. We want to make sure that people are not getting in debt to go to university or college or go to post-secondary. That's why we want to eliminate all interest on us on student loans and making sure we work towards making post-secondary part of our public system. You shouldn't have to go in debt to go to school. And finally, if you're going to create jobs, let's invest in actual good jobs, 300,000 green new jobs that are based on good paying jobs that young people can actually work towards and find a career in. That is our plan.
Thank you for saving me having to mention green new jobs. I appreciate that. The youth. I don't think you need to set up a youth council to actually talk to youth. People are standing right here, and it's pretty straightforward what's required. It seems to me that if you don't have any money, that's a big issue that needs to be addressed. So economic development is very, 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 very high on that list of things to put in place, including green jobs. It's going to be a boom time. Forget the internet boom time. The green economy is going to be huge. And there needs to be some sense of hope. Now, hope is an overused word, but there needs to be some sense that there's a point to aspire, that we're not going to destroy the planet, that there will be meaningful employment. We're not just going to be taken over by robots. And to add to this, well, it's a real thing. AI is an issue. The jobs are getting fewer and fewer. And so the Green Party has committed to free post-secondary education so the youth can get meaningfully trained in these new emerging technologies and take care of the future that, frankly, some of the older folks have screwed up.
Been in the running. I've had an opportunity to actually interact with a lot of youth. I do have youth that are volunteering with me who are from this high school on my campaign. And one of the biggest things that I've learned, and one of the biggest things that I know about youth in general, is that, I mean, it's quite obvious, they are our future. And my question is, why are we as adults making these decisions for them? If we want to empower them to be functional in the long term and have sustainability in terms of their jobs and their education, we need to hear from them. We need, and I promise you this, I'm very active within youth communities maybe not in York South-Weston, but I will be soon. Regardless if I get elected or not, ladies and gentlemen, I have a lot to give. My experience has been working in developing communities, helping youth get out of poverty firsthand. My door will always be open, and I think that's what the community of Southwest needs, because from what I've been hearing, you're not being heard, and that's the biggest issue here.
Thank you.
Peter's wife is mom, that's all.
Oh,
My name is Lestal. I'm 18. This is my first year voting. I wanted to know, specifically to Ahmed Hussein, as a Minister of Immigration, as well as I'm a child of an immigrant, I wanted to know what you would be doing, or any of the parties will be doing, to cancel or adjust the third safe country agreement, as well as the people who have been targeted in Weston Road and Lawrence for immigration purposes. Which is also conflicting with the racist anti-immigration Trump policy that's also aiding the Trump administration. I want to know what's being done to aid that, or adjust that, or cancel that agreement.
So the audio quality up here is quite poor. We got a lot of echo. We couldn't really hear the question.
I wanted to know, there's the third safe country agreement, which is complicit with the anti-immigration laws, with the American anti-immigration laws, as well as immigration officers who are targeting and policing people randomly and harassing them within the community. I want to know specifically, because Ahmed Hussein is the Minister of Immigration, as well as any other party, what they're going to be doing to aid the discrimination that's been happening to immigrants within this community.
Thank you for your question. I want to take this opportunity to categorically deny that that is happening. It is false, and it is something that has been perpetuated, unfortunately, spread misinformation by my NDP opponent. Immigration officers and CBSA officers do not, I repeat, do not engage in racial profiling. And if they do, report them to the nearest law enforcement officers. It is not federal government policy to do that. Those reports have been false, and it is unfortunate that my NDP opponent has spread that misinformation, and he should be ashamed of himself. Yes. I didn't get a chance to respond earlier.
No, it's because the question was posed to you, it's individual.
Okay.
It's the rules.
So, I only spread what City TV News said. So, City TV News said that there is a racial profiling. Second of all, myself and NDP, we absolutely agree we need to end the Safe Third Country Agreement. When we put people on asylum, it is about making sure that they're safe, and that is our priority. It doesn't matter if it's in the United States. If they're not safe, they're not safe. And on top of that, we need to make sure we're speeding up things like family reunification, because when families come here, like as my family came here, we need to make sure that they're coming together, and that has to be a priority. And then also, once they get here, we need to make sure they can actually afford to live here, like finding affordable housing, like getting access to healthcare, like actually getting access to childcare. Those are the things that are our priority.
I'm glad this is raised, because I think, frankly, the Minister of Immigration's conduct is disgraceful. I feel that we're talking about sustainable immigration here. It's important as a nation that we welcome newcomers, but you cannot do it without providing the infrastructure to support them. And putting 14,000 new immigrants into our system put a burden on an already broken shelter system. And if you're looking to find blame as to why there is more bigotry on the streets, because people are feeling resentment about this, you need no further than the mirror, sir.
Stance against immigration. And so I just want to clarify that. We are actually, we actually want to make sure that we have fair, compassionate immigration. Really? Because look at me. I'm an immigrant. People, let's just clarify for one second, all right? At the end of the day, regardless of who you are, where you're from, the Conservative Party does not stop you from coming here. We believe in freedom of religion, freedom of religious choice, freedom of culture, ethic, diversity.
So the People's Party treats everyone exactly the same. So what we're going to do as far as immigration policy, and just to set the record straight, because I know there's some fake news out there about our party, is we are actually going to double the amount of skilled immigrants coming into the country, and we're also going to prioritize all refugees around the world equally, as based on the most that needed the most to come to Canada. So we're treating everyone the same. We're not going to pick and choose and play identity politics.
So whoever this person was asking a question is now given to me. So it's to all candidates. If given a chance, what will you do, or what are your plans to combat mental health issues? Mental health is a big issue that can lead to violence, crimes, and other harmful doings. And can I have Alexis Taylor, please?
No one should have to struggle to get the care they need. That is absolutely mandatory on our we should. No one should have to struggle to get the care they need. Working in this community, one of the biggest struggles actually helping young people and their families was actually connecting them to mental health supports, because it is such a limited system right now, because we treat healthcare as something, mental health as something that's separate from the rest of our healthcare. That is why we believe in full head-to-toe coverage for our healthcare system. That includes, in addition to pharmacare, actual full coverage for mental health coverage, because we've seen how this has been left behind, and we can't afford four more years of continued broken promises by the same liberal Tory story. Continued letting the healthcare system deteriorate in front of our eyes. And so that's why we are committed to full coverage for mental health supports.
The idea of discriminating on the basis of the kind of illness you have is abhorrent to both myself and my party. And conflating criminality with mental health is not something I'm comfortable doing, if I heard that in the question. The fact of the matter is that being poor, if you don't have a mental health issue before you have become poor, you will afterwards. If poverty causes mental health issues, it causes physical illnesses. Green Party is committed to full, universal, and by the way, a universal federal standard right across all the provinces, because the provinces actually dish out the health care. We're already on record on that. You can go to the website and read all about it. But this again, we keep on coming back to this. Canada Health Act says that our services should be universal and portable and transportable, and that you should be able to get the same excellent quality of care in York, south-weston as you do in Brunswick and anywhere else. And the federal government, as my colleagues have said, continued to drop the ball on this one, and they promised, oh, we'll do it in the next election. Well, enough is enough. I think we could also, frankly, use a little more local physical and mental health support right here in York, south-weston. I think we're desperately underserved in terms of facilities to treat people. So that's another thing I would focus on locally.
This country is, poor mental health care is increasing at an alarming rate. It's affecting children at the age of 10, and it's affecting seniors and everyone in between. Our previous Conservative government made significant investments to help address the issue and they encourage a dialogue about those who are affected to help them find solutions. So one of the things that we are going to guarantee is that we're going to going to put funding towards social programs and health care transfers, and we're going to keep the 3% that is currently been mandated. We're also going to, it's important for federal funding to really be it's important for federal funding for healthcare to be, it's important for public healthcare to be accessible by all Canadians. And to ensure that it happens, the federal government needs to be actively involved and with helping provinces in maintaining their healthcare programs.
Mental health. Interesting enough, I was my first 5 years after during high school, I worked at the mental health facility in Nova Scotia called the Nova Scotia Hospital. And I remember back in those days, I think the hospital did a fantastic job, at least from my perspective, it was a great hospital. The People's Party has issues with sort of what's going on tonight with the healthcare. As people are pointing fingers, you know, we need a national healthcare plan. We need more local support to healthcare. Well, healthcare is delivered by the provinces and managed by the provinces, and we want to pass on the money, but not allow finger pointing. So you're going to negotiate, get the money for your healthcare, and you will be responsible for delivering healthcare and not pointing fingers, giving excuses why you haven't done your job.
The mental health issue is really, really a priority for us. We understand clearly that it is important, number one, to fight the stigma around mental health, to encourage folks to feel comfortable to come forward and seek treatment and help that they require. And secondly, in office, the Liberal Party of Canada is the party that increased federal funding for targeted towards mental health from $0 under the Conservatives to over $6 billion. And not only that, we increased the allocations from the provinces, both under the Canada Health Transfer and the Canada Social Transfer. We promised as Liberals that we will be there for communities, we will be there for provinces with dedicated, sustainable, and predictable funding. That's what the federal government is supposed to do for the provinces. We've kept our end of the bargain. I didn't interrupt you before. We've kept our end of the bargain. We want to make sure that we enable that funding to continue so that local communities can rely on our funding to plan ahead and to put the necessary supports in place to enable Canadians who are affected by mental health challenges to be able to seek their help.
Scott, come on.
Hi, my name is Alexis Taylor. This is for everyone. What is your party's plan for improving public transportation in Toronto?
Well, obviously, public transportation is key to reducing carbon emissions, and so we are committed to doing that across Canada and, of course, across York South-Weston. One of the challenges I see here in Toronto, in this neighborhood particularly, is that we have buses operating right now that are theoretically 50-50 hybrids, but I rarely see them actually operating on the electric cycle. And what that means is that here in York South-Weston, we have some of the worst air quality in the country. Dangerous levels from the air pollution. I've got a few stats here. 1,500 people every year in Toronto die from airborne pollution. That's more than guns and even getting run over by buses. It's breathing down air behind us that's more dangerous. So I think transportation that is green in nature, comprehensive, so that you can physically get from this part of the world to the other without the requirement of a personal vehicle, is part and parcel, is hard-coded into the DNA of what the Green Party is about. But I can't emphasize this enough. We need to stop having to use these to breathe in our neighborhood. We need air, we don't have car sinkings in the air, but we're breathing right now. This is like burying the lead. This is not a polar bear on an ice cream stuff. This is right here, right now.
Behind in terms of our public transportation system, and there's a lot that can be done. So our party is committed to working in infrastructure to reduce commute times for citizens so that they can spend more time with their families and things that matter more to them than waiting in traffic.
So again, that's a really local question regarding Toronto Transit. We just heard, I think, yesterday or today, I believe, the promises made with the mayor, John Tory, with the upgrades coming, with the money that was promised. And I think about every 4 years, there's a big promise of money coming into the transit system. It just seems to happen. The timing is quite interesting. I think the People's Party would like to see transit initiatives made available through economic growth in the country, because there's a lot of the places in Canada that don't have transit system. And I use the transit every day. I think it's a great system. I know it's a hot button item for Toronto, a very hot button. To be honest with you, it's, again, you get the money through transfer payments for your transit, and the promises, we're not gonna pander to the promises.
Look at our record, $2.5 billion a year, $25 billion over 10 years in the last mandate to make sure that we again have predictable, sustainable, long-term funding for transit. What has that resulted in? That has resulted in the TTC being able to plan long-term for the first time. Because under 10 years, under the Conservatives, the decisions about the priority projects were made in Ottawa, not in Toronto, not in York South-Western, not in the parts of Toronto that needed the investments based on the projects that matter to the people. We changed that. Not only did we do that, myself and our Liberal colleagues, we went to the government and we said, providing transit dollars on a per capita basis is not fair to Toronto, because we have the biggest ridership in the whole country. So we should allocate transit money based on the actual number of riders who take transit. And guess what? The formula was changed, and we are now getting the biggest percentage, the lion's share, transit funding proportionally across the whole country. Not only that, we've funded M60 projects behind the scenes, changing the tracks, fixing the signals, making subway stations more accessible. I could go on and on.
I think our Liberal candidate should go on and on, because just today the Star reported that that the Liberals have decided they're going, Liberal insiders are telling us that they're going to actually partner with Doug Ford to fund his relief line. While their own Liberal Adam Vaughan was saying that that plan is designed, written on a napkin. So what is it? It's the same Liberal Tory story. In fact, let's just be honest, people, Liberals are conservatives. So my work in this community, we know in York Southwestern we have more transit. Anyone who's ridden the 89 Weston has seen that. Anyone who's had to ride the 32 on Eglinton right now has seen that. So we know, and I've done this advocacy myself, trying to make sure that the Up Express is actually integrated into the TTC, because it's unaffordable. And that was something brought in by our provincial. provincial Liberals, thank you very much. And so this is where we're at. We are committed to, as an NDP at the federal level, to make sure that we build fair, free transit. If we're going to actually encourage transit ridership, if we're going to actually make sure that people are using public transportation, we should not be treating it as a business. We should make sure that it's an actual form of transportation that doesn't price people out of it. And we need to, if we're going to protect the environment, we need to update the whole fleet to be zero-emission vehicles. That is what our plan is about. Actually, for you, not just to give away big tax breaks to the country.
Oversight, because my question to the former immigration minister is about your party's performance on the Trans Mountain Pipeline and whether Indigenous peoples in BC have been given free, prior, informed consent for that. And I also wonder about the restoration of protection for navigable waters. That was, I think, something that was promised that hasn't happened. And we need a cleanup of Grassy Narrows and the Amanjuang in Sarnia that promises to clean up those communities and finish up with the boil water advisories that exist across this country. And finally, that's a long question, many parts. Are you going to bring back proportional representation?
No, I'll answer actually the second one because I take offense to the fact that she's not acknowledging the 87 boil water advisories that have been lifted for 87 communities. We've spent four times the investments that were done under the Kelowna Accord. That is real progress. Is the job done? Absolutely not. But let us not minimize the progress that has been made. 87 communities now have water, drinkable water, because of Liberal investments to remove boil water advisories. That is a fact. In terms of the pipeline, we are following the process laid out by the Court of Appeal that the Conservatives bungled. We know, we understand more than any other party in this country that you have to protect the environment but also grow the economy. The NDP want to protect the environment but destroy the economy. The Conservatives want to grow the economy and destroy the environment. We are the only party that understands that you need to grow the economy and protect the environment at the same time.
No, I think that was addressed to all of us. That was addressed to all of us.
Comment.
30 seconds to respond to that. I got to object. Point of order. That's just not fair. We need more time.
That's such a low bar to talk about the Kelowna Accord and the Conservative government, but you know that's the same Liberal Tory story I've been saying, right? They compare themselves to that low bar. Let's talk about what we want to do. We actually want to bring in full recognition of Indigenous peoples as nation-to-nation conciliation and community building by full implementation of the United Nations Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. We need to make sure we're immediately investing in clean water and infrastructure across all Indigenous communities right across this country. That is what we need to do. And we know here in Weston, we have large amounts of Indigenous communities that we can be addressing immediately with that kind of plan. So 87 boil water advisories is a very low bar in my opinion. And in terms of electoral reform,
we are committed to mixed member proportional system that would allow us to actually have a local representative and choose the party you want representing you in Ottawa. And so that is real representation that we're talking about. And in my view, Liberals have not been protecting the environment or the economy. So that's
is correct. This is an incredibly low bar. The hierarchy of needs, basic need is clean water. We don't have it in York, South-Weston. We should have it right across Canada. That is a primary thing that our government should and must do. Period, simple, the end. It's not negotiable. To say that we spend four times as much as somebody else is not an acceptable answer. We spent $4.5 billion on a pipeline to nowhere to sell our assets. We could use that money to help Canadians. I'm stunned at the terrible sir. I dare you to put a price on water. We want the Canadians. I dare you.
Last year, I actually worked on a grant to help Indigenous people get clean water in areas because of these issues. I actually learned a lot about that last year when I was working on this. And one of the biggest things, regardless of that they say that they have cleared 87 wildfire advisories, did they also mention that a lot of those have flipped back? And a lot of them have, like, it's not a long-term sustainable thing. It's very important, and I agree with my colleagues when, as Canadians, we need to have accessible to clean water regardless of your background, regardless of your socioeconomic status. It's very important. And I believe that we've done a disservice to Indigenous people in this country. And my personal goal is to help rectify that. In terms of our party, this may not be popular with the people in this room, but we believe that we need to continue building the pipeline. And the reason I'm saying this is because it provides good jobs. Everybody here knows this. Everybody here in this room is complaining that they are not having enough jobs, job opportunities. This goes across the country. By stopping this pipeline, we're also affecting other Canadians' lives and their livelihood and the ability to earn money.
A couple points. I think the budget last year, or the budget for Indigenous support, is $21 billion. So I'm pretty sure there's something going wrong if you have a water problem on their reserves. The party, the People's Party, we actually want to open up a dialogue and take a look at the whole relationship we have with Indigenous people. We actually want to take a look at the Indian Act. If you're not aware of what the Indian Act does, it actually puts a lot of handcuffs, so to speak, on what you can do with the money and how it's transferred, and there's virtually no property rights for Indigenous people under the Indian Act. So we're looking at starting a new relationship. Thank you.
Could you please outline your party's policy towards nuclear power as a component of the energy mix we will need to reduce carbon emissions and reach international climate targets? Sorry. Could you please outline your party's policy towards nuclear power as a component of the energy mix we will need to reduce carbon emissions and reach international climate targets?
Thank you for that question. Well, first I'd like to start off by saying that our current government has not reached the Paris Accord requirements that we were supposed to meet. In fact, we are way far below. One of the biggest things that we're doing, or one of the things we believe in, is that we need to create a national energy corridor across Canada. This is a way we're going to dedicate a coast-to-coast energy infrastructure project, which will look at will make it less complicated for industry to submit proposals about different sources of energy generation, whether it's wind, whether it's oil, whether it's... and so with a single corridor, we believe that we can minimize the environmental impacts and lower the cost of environmental assessments. So that's what our...
So People's Party has a broad scope when it comes to environmental assessments. We think there's serious problems with environmental assessments the way it's set up now. Particularly to nuclear power, if you're not aware, there's what they call fourth generation nuclear power, which is being stifled for two reasons. The environmental assessment to even to contemplate putting a nuclear plant in will stop the project virtually right there in its tracks. And secondly, there's no investment coming into Canada to support such a large infrastructure project because of the various other problems we have with our economy, and the money's leaving the country. There's not a lot coming into our country right now, so we want to change our economic stature. Thank you.
Investments in innovation and research and innovation and commercialization of green technology has been a key priority for us. We have invested heavily to not only research and develop new green technologies, but to also commercialize them and share them with the rest of the world as we try to combat, together with them, the challenge of global climate change. But in addition to that, this is a huge economic opportunity for Canada. The green economy is projected to create over $15 trillion in value over the next number of years. And Canada, because of the steps we've taken, because of the research credits that we've put in place and the other incentives, we are well positioned, because of the Liberal Party's leadership on this, to be a global leader, not only in research and development and innovation, but to actually commercialize that and to allow Canadian small, medium, and large enterprises to benefit from that. And our progressive trade deals are allowing those that diversification to happen and that wealth and prosperity to be generated. So not only are we turning the environment into an opportunity to do better in terms of health and safety, but also a commercial opportunity that will do, that will contribute to not only good paying jobs, but prosperity for all of us.
Our commitment is to clean energy, clean renewable energy. And that means making sure that these are things that can't harm our environment. And so that's, nuclear doesn't fall under that. And that's why we would not be supporting a nuclear in that way. Our focus is on clean renewable energy. That's, for example, I've been working in this community, for example, to stop the building of a gas plant that the provincial Liberals tried to shoehorn in on us just a couple years ago, that many in this room were also involved in as well too. And that's the kind of work that we need to be seeing at the federal level as well too. The Liberals bought a pipeline. I think that automatically disqualifies them from talking about any sort of green technology or green investment. We need to make sure that those kinds of decisions are part of the legal that we stand in terms of things like gas plants or nuclear energy as well too. So that is where our stance is at. Thank you for the question.
Thank you for the question. I think $4.5 billion would go a long way to support the green economy. Too bad we spent it on a pipeline. The question about nuclear energy is interesting. No idea is thrown off the table, but I will say, in the Green Party, we think there are undeveloped areas right here, right now, in York South-Weston, where we can access local power. Think global, act local. So we have access in this region to geothermal through Lake Ontario, hydroelectric. I walked down the Humber River. We used to have a mill down here. That's the basis of hydroelectric power. We have wind turbine and solar energy sources. If they're close enough to the point of use, we don't have that waste by going down those long power lines. So I'm not dismissing the idea of any way of generating clean, renewable energy. It's just that we haven't done even a fraction of what's closely available through geothermal, hydroelectric turbines and solar energy right here, right now. And a big jobs to New York South-Weston.
Good evening. This is addressed to all the candidates. talked about housing a little bit. Maybe we could hear in each individual's opinions about a new rental stock on city-owned land in York Southwestern, where the zoning will be inclusionary and affordable for the low-income residents of York Southwestern.
Well, from an opinion point of view, there should be better city planning, I would suspect. As I drive around the neighborhood, I see how the clusters are set up and how the housing. I guess traditionally, there were single family homes that took up most of the space, and then if there's any pattern similar to that, you tear down a lot of the older houses and you're building condo units are taking their place. Affordability, I think, has to be linked to the economy and growth and lower taxes. Give you more choices, to be honest with you. And it's probably a local consultation to put pressure on city planners. I think it really resides with city planners.
At the end of the day, housing, as I said, is a comprehensive issue. We have to deal with enabling first-time home buyers to access a safe, affordable place to live. We have to invest more in affordable housing, in social housing. But we also have to enable and incentivize the construction of low-cost rental housing stock. We are doing that already. The Liberal Party of Canada in government put money in 2016 and after that as part of the National Housing Strategy to enable developers, to encourage them and to incentivize them to build more affordable rental housing units. We have also made sure that the subsidies that are part of co-op housing, the units that are subsidized for seniors, for other folks who need housing, are secured, not only for 1 year as we did in 2016, in the interim, but once the National Housing Strategy came into place, for a long period of time. So we're tackling this on a number of aspects, but I can assure you that we have demonstrated time and again that when the municipal government comes forward with creative solutions on housing, they will find in us a credible and reliable partner for housing. Sorry?
Thank you, Judith. And thank you for the question, Bob. Unfortunately, I think our Liberal incumbents have spent some time in the riding. This is not an affordable place to live. I don't know where this money that is being talked about that's been spent since 2016 is going, but it's definitely not in York Southwestern, and it's definitely not in the city of Toronto, and maybe not even in the country. I don't know where it's going, because we see a housing crisis all across us right now. And so affordability is a mandatory component. And affordability means, like we said, you should 30% of your income. How many people in this room, how many people in this city are paying more than 30% of their income just to pay for their rent? That is the reality of what we have right now. One of the things that I've been involved in this community is helping start tenants associations right across this community who are to help residents stand up to greedy landlords who are being protected by liberal governments to make sure that they make all the profits they can get on substandard housing. That is the work that I'm doing right now, and that's the work I want to carry to Ottawa. But we also want to make sure that we do is we want to make sure that an NDP government would turn all federal land, owned lands that are unused, into affordable housing. This is something we started announcing right across the city, and we want to do in all urban centers across this country. That is a real plan to making sure that people can afford to live in this community and make sure that they can have a lifestyle that allows them to raise their families. So thank you very much for the question.
The sitting MP is quick to take credit for regional issues, but runs for cover as soon as there's actually a detailed question out there. So thank you for asking this question. One of the things that the Liberal government has failed to do is to ease transferring usage from condos to rental usage. There's a tax penalty in place there. That could be fixed very, very quickly. As to the affordability point, one of the big problems that you're no doubt aware of is that that is based on the average market rent. As we know, the average market rent in Toronto is way too high. And so affordable is affordable by whom? Similarly, but I will say one thing that I am in favor of is that we need mixed-use facilities. What works well is not warehousing people in large vertical towers where they are isolated from each other, but having blended communities of young and old, different size units for people to use. But none of this is all moot if they are not actually affordable. And if it's $2,300, I think was mentioned, I think that's about right. That is not affordable. It's not affordable if you're poor, and a lot of people here are poor. So.
So affordable housing, as I mentioned before, one of the things that we're doing is trying to make it more accessible for people who are looking to get into the market. Whether you are a millennial who is getting a mortgage, we're going to reduce the mortgage to 30 years, and we're going to also reduce the stress test, as I mentioned before. The other thing I also want to clarify is that I think we also need to, besides a federal government responsibility, I think as a community responsibility, we need to look at the strain we are putting on the communities that we are all in, right? And this in terms of everything, looking at how we can spread across the country in terms of strain on the systems, in terms of maybe providing more opportunities for people that are a little bit outside of the city that they can afford. I mean, there's so many issues with housing, I know that, and I am surprised and appalled at the condition of housing in this area, as well as the government housing, and I've been privy to hearing a lot of the details about that. So I think that we need to really look at the standards and look at how people are getting away with not doing what they're supposed to do.
Can I have Loretta Conte up?
So I think Lisa needs to tell us two.
Hello,
questions.
Can you hear me?
Lisa, tell us two questions.
You mentioned before that in very derogatory terms, even your leader, about refugees and immigration. Your party wants to 50% cut immigration. We cannot find skilled workers. We cannot find. How can we build, how can you create jobs when the jobs are there? There's nobody to fill. How can you do it? And your party, a member of your party, yeah, my question is coming. A member of your party has called the refugee.
Excuse me, so please tell me where you received that.
Excuse me, thank you, sir. Will you raise your hand?
Oh, I do know my platform. In fact,
I'm telling you, you don't know because that's your platform.
I mean, show me your platform.
Excuse me, sir, can you let her answer the question, please? I think you've made your point. You can let her answer the question. I think you said your point.
However, and I would like to point out, everybody is saying that the other party is still, supporting immigration. I don't know how many people in this room, but I've talked to many people in this community who are coming in under the local government who still are separated from their families. I've spoken to Somalians, I've spoken to Nigerians, I've spoken to so many people across this. Yes, and you know what? I have. And let me tell you this, it doesn't matter where you're from, and that's the point. At the end of the day, if you're in fact, we think that we need to reinforce more economic immigration and reinforce the fact that there's so many skilled people in this country who previous governments have not identified their skill set or recognized them, and that's important. We need to do that so we have the good people who come here can actually do the job that they've been trained to do, and this government has failed to do that.
What does threat mean? Threat means cockroach. That's why a lot of people get cockroach.
C'est très important de parler les langues officielles du Canada. Et I invite notre député de parler en français. My name is Nicky Ward. I do speak French. I do also speak Spanish. I speak enough Italian to get into trouble. And one of the things that we dealt with it is a terrible shame and evidence of the poor level of support for people in York Southwestern is that our literacy and language rates in this riding are very, very poor, amongst the lowest in the country. So I would support increasing the level of education so that all folks here can at least have a high level of proficiency in tout les deux de la langue officielle de Canada.
So again, I'm going to make the, because we're the newest party, I'd like to invite you to check out our policy on specific question. We're going to double skilled immigration in Canada. We recognize that there's a shortage in the construction industry and lots of specialized fields, and that is right in our policy. I have it right here. If somebody wants the CEO back and take a look at it, or please go online. So it's not as simple as that. We know there's a crisis, and there's, I believe there's party in power. We sort of stalled a couple of previous programs that were in place over the last 4 years. So I would do some research on that, because some of the programs were supposedly in place, but they weren't utilized. Thank you.
I just wanted to quickly state that I think that our platform as NDP is all about protecting everyday people, working people. And that includes our businesses in York Southwest and small businesses especially. When we look at things like a universal pharmacare, dental care, vision care coverage, a universal expanded health care program, that helps businesses because now that removes one of the biggest costs, labor costs, off the tabs of businesses. We want to expand child care to make sure we have a universal child care because the vast majority of people who are straddled with raising children are women, and we are hurting our economy by making sure 50% can't work when we don't have affordable child care. We want to make sure we have true immigration that includes family reunification, and when they get here, they can live here, and making sure that the super rich pay their fair share. The top 1% need to pay their taxes, and that is what we're committed to.
In York Southwestern, we have now more money. I was able to deliver hundreds of thousands of dollars in new funding for foreign trained credentials to be transitioned into Canadian society. We have way more money to fund all the settlement and integration organizations in York Southwestern to integrate and settle newcomers and to enable them to have the support that they need to succeed faster, because when they succeed, Canada succeeds. But I really want to take an opportunity to address the conservative opponent. Her party
not many years ago, a few weeks ago, released a flyer that accused 50% of refugees as being criminal. That is false. It's demonizing refugees, and that's a shame.
Actually, if you're swinging mud, could you be more specific? Because I can only get out of the way here.
Go ahead. Under the conservative watch, families were kept apart for between 7 to 8 years. We've lowered the wait times to 12 months or less. I'm proud of the record that we have had in immigration to stand up to the hatred and the divisive nature.
Their child,
and the government should help them out. I believe this is an issue that is key to the economic development of Canada, but also to the inclusion of women, because a lot of times they're the ones who need to be assisted in order to be able to participate in the workplace and to be able to have access to early child care and early learning, not only before but after school, is critical. We have already created 40,000 childcare spaces in Canada. We promised to deliver 200,000 more childcare spaces for Canadians. This is a serious issue that needs to be tackled. We know the importance that it has for working families. We are losing economic opportunity by not allowing everyone to fully participate in our economy. And one of the key ways in which to do that, to enable, for example, more women to participate in our economy, is to address the issue of childcare. You can count on the fact that the Liberal Party of Canada, re-elected Liberal government, will invest more in childcare, make sure that we collaborate with the provinces, and if they refuse to come to the table, work directly with municipal governments, as we have in the past, to address this issue.
Question, and it is a truly important time. I relate to myself actually. I'm a single father, and I have a daughter in daycare right now. And without the use of childcare, would not be able to work. I'm in this community. I meet so many single parent families who need to access to childcare, and their only options are paying $2,000 a month per child or waiting in some long waiting list for the subsidy. And that is where we're at. And yet, you know, I mean, I appreciate the Liberal candidate's response, but they've been promising the child care since 1993. I mean, Doug Gilmore and Wendell Clark were still leading the Leafs to what we thought was the Stanley Cup Finals at that time. This is how long we've been waiting. So we can't, once again, wait for the same Liberal Tory story. We can't afford it. That's why our commitment is to making sure we invest $1 billion in child care by 2020, creating 500,000 child care spaces, licensed childcare spaces across this country, and we want to work towards $10 a day childcare as soon as possible. That is a plan to make sure that all people can work, men and women in our community, and that's what I'm saying. Thank you very
much. Well, I think that there's a point of personal privilege at stake here. I think some of the remarks made by the gentleman to the right here about my colleagues to the left are objectionable and misogynistic in nature. So I'd like that to go on record, but I'd like then to ask the question and restart my time, please. Universal child care is a fundamental plank of the Green Party. It does, as you've rightly said, affect women quite disproportionately. I think my colleagues' comments are laughable in terms of supporting women who want to stay in the workplace seems to me they tend to get booted out of cabinet and forced to run as an independent. So I think it's not about supporting women in politics and women in the workplace, and disingenuous, and that's been very, very, very kind. This has been promised for years, and you know what those promises have yielded. Nothing. 0.000. The Green Party is all about holding these guys' toes to the fire. Fine, take our platform, take our ideas, but for God's sakes, implement them. I'm sure you're going to hold some toes to the fire.
Thank you. That's a great question. I have an 8-year-old daughter, and so childcare was something that I had struggled with. I mean, not in North Southwestern, but even in my neck of the woods. And I understand the struggle. Our party doesn't have anything definitive about that, but I would like to say that that is something that I will personally look into if I'm elected, because I do understand what that's like. I also want to point out the fact that we're talking about women and women accessibility to work. Well, why, one of the things we haven't discussed here is how come in this day and age, with all the, and our new progressive government or whatever, that women are still getting paid less in the workforce than men? Can somebody explain that to me? In this day and age, and this happens across the sectors, and this is fundamental to talking about accessibility to childcare. Because if we're getting pension paid, say, maybe we would have more money to give to that, right? So I think that's a fundamental issue. It happens in our educational institutions. I've taught at universities. I've seen it with my colleagues. I've seen that they've been getting unequal pay, and this is a fundamental problem. And this is actually what is created, if you look at the culture of our society and what we're deeming as women and what our expectations are, the government has not been supporting that. And I guarantee you this, I will strive to ensure that women in this community will have access to childcare, and also I'm gonna work on making sure we all get paid the same, because it doesn't matter what sex you are, we all deserve to work to get paid the same.
The People's Party is going to be quite different than what we just heard on this issue. It is a good question. We're going to say that this is a provincial jurisdiction, and I'll explain it. In Quebec, they have very good health care, child care system in Quebec, and they use the transfer payments from the federal government to mainly fund that system. They have some really good examples in Quebec on how to do it fairly efficiently. They do get the money through the federal government through payments of debt. The solution probably resides in the community and in the province. So we work with the provincial government to come up with what's best fit for Ontario, because this is the big city of Toronto, and it's not going to be the same in rural Saskatchewan. Seconds is not much time, so I'll just say the People's Party, please visit our website to look at our policies. You're going to find that we're going to do politics quite differently. A lot of the questions today I thought were very localized questions, not at the federal level, which is what we're supposed to be representing. I do understand the questions important here. Again, Canada believes in smaller government, more sovereignty for Canadians to make their own decisions, and less bureaucracy, so we'll get all the promises we heard tonight just make government bigger, bloated, and slower, and inefficient.
Canada, I truly believe, is one of the best countries in the world. I've been to 50 different countries in 262 cities, and yes, my carbon footprint must be a mess. But I want to say that in all that time, there's no other country in the world that I would rather live in. And why? It's because of the people here, it's because of our beliefs. It's the fact that as a woman, ethnic minority, I can stand here in front of you today and try to represent you in the next federal, and represent you in the next federal election to be your representative. That in itself shows me how great this country is. And to be honest, on October 21st, why you should vote for me is because I truly I truly walk the walk and talk the talk. You can look anything up about me, but I've devoted my life to helping those in need, not only in Canada, but overseas, regardless of my party affiliation. Thank you.
Too bad the Liberals didn't fulfill their promise of proportional representation, otherwise we would have a fair race in this way. Here's the deal. Andrew Scheer has no chance at becoming the leader of the next government. Sorry. This is not a conservative riding. You can vote your conscience here. Even if you split the vote three ways between us, I'm still not going to get it. Sorry. So here's the thing. With your one vote, what are you going to do? What are you going to vote? You're going to vote for the same old, nothing changes, nothing changes. Are you going to put your fingers in their eye and vote green? Because that sends a powerful message. It's a way for your vote to count doubly. The web gets in, show them that they have something to be scared of. Otherwise, it's the same old. That's what you vote for me, straightforward.
Thank you everybody for having me here. Thank you to the organizers for organizing this. My name is Yafa Tawabe. This election is about priorities. And my priority is you, because I'm your neighbor. I live in this community, so that's why I want to represent you, because I know what it takes but for everyday people, working people. Liberals have showed us what their priorities are. They're going to protect the rich. Same old liberal Tory story. We've seen it before. We'll see it again. That's what this election's about. So, October 21st. Vote Yafa Tawabe, vote Jagmeet Singh, vote the NDP, have someone on your side because we're in it for you. I look forward to representing you in Ottawa. It would be an honor and thank you very much.
In 2015, you sent me to Ottawa to be a strong community voice. 2019 marks 20 years of my involvement and connection to York Southwest. And Yafa, I have knocked on 10 times more doors than you. So don't question my presence in your in York Southwestern. 26,000 children are receiving more help under the Canada Child Benefit. $966 million delivered for seniors right here in York Southwestern. $73.2 million for flood mitigation. I have delivered, I will continue to deliver for you, and I will do it in the most respectful way, which is to continue to knock on doors every time that I'm back in the riding, which is every weekend when I'm back in Toronto. Otherwise, strong community voice for you in honor.
Experience that the system we use tonight allows time for about twice as many people to ask their questions compared to when questions are not pre-prepared. So we think we've done the best we can.
What about the gun ban? How is that going to protect us? How is that going to
protect us? I would like...
No, I have too many friends...
What the fuck are you doing?
Hey, what's your language?
No,
I would encourage you to discuss it with the candidates when they come out and are after they leave here,
we
hope they'll be outside.
How are we going to handle the gun bass?
Excuse me.
5 minutes for the question.
That's all we need. 5 minutes, right, guys? Gun bass?
Away from door-to-door canvassing in order to take part in tonight's event. They are the stars of this event, and they all worked hard to make it worthwhile for us, their audience. And don't forget that all of them have put their lives on hold for many weeks as part of the electoral process. So thank you all, candidates. I also want to thank the many volunteers here tonight. Forgive me if I single out our moderator, Judith Hayes, our timer, Sherry Hurst, microphone manager, Suri Weinberg, Rick Cicerelli, and the other members of his questions team who toiled away all evening. Also, Mike Mattis has been managing the sound system. Videographer Peter Muscat. You can see the entire thing on video on our Mount Dennis website, Mount Dennis CA website. And also Dave Bennett, who welcomed you all at the start of the evening. I won't name all of the many other volunteers who took part in this evening, nor the many who spent time spreading the word of the event on social media, talking it up with neighbors, and putting up hundreds of signs. But they all worked hard to make it happen, and I thank them, every one. Finally, I want to thank Western Collegiate Institute for accommodating our event, and the school board for waiving all fees. And I particularly want to thank our student volunteers, and I'd like you to come up here, please, all five of you. And they've been on the job since 6 o'clock tonight. Woo! And we promised the school we would get a photograph of them, all of the candidates, with the five volunteers here, so we're going to be doing that in just a moment. After that, I believe all of the candidates will be staying outside the front of the school for a while, so you can meet them and ask one-on-one questions, so please feel free to do that. A couple of other quick things. I would like to thank the audience member, I'm not sure if she's still here, who suggested that we needed to sing O Canada again. I think that was absolutely the right way to start. Thank you. And I also want to thank the audience member who made a point of pointing out that we have not done an Indigenous Lands acknowledgement. And again, thank you for the right time. Acknowledge the audience member who pointed out that our building signage on the outside, particularly where doors were locked, was not helpful because there was no signage on those locked doors. We will do better next time. Finally, don't have a safe journey home and don't forget to vote on Monday.